What is the Schomburg Center? To me, it is home. The place where we come to see who we really are, not just somebody else's reflection of who we are.
The Schomburg Center is a place of culture. It's a place of history. It's a place of knowledge.
The Schomburg Center, to me, is a repository of all of the things that has documented our sense of worth as a people.
For me, that means that it is a place of immense power.
The Schomburg Center is a public research library and a cultural institution
for the study of the Pan-African world.
It is perhaps the best in the world.
My Schomburg Center is Arturo Alfonso Schomburg.
Arturo Schomburg said, Black history and culture and intellect exists at a time when most people didn't believe that. He collected those evidences, and that became the beginning of the collection.
And it has expanded and has grown to where it is now a world-class institution.
It holds over 10 million items.
There's no parallel anywhere that brings to light what we as people of color have done, what we continue to do.
Black culture is all of culture. The universals that animate everyone's life happen here. For all people.
The Schomburg for me is one of the center pillars of Harlem. When I started the journey of finding out about Red Rooster and Harlem, the very first place I went to was the Schomburg.
Researchers from around the world come and use what we have here.
I could not have written just about any of the books that I've written without the Schomburg Center's archives, resources.
The Schomburg Center is much more than a library. We encourage lifelong learning and exploration.
The Junior Scholars Program is a Saturday program with students from fifth grade to senior year in high school to help them learn about Black history and culture.
Learning about my history is important because it teaches me who I am.
The Schomburg Junior Scholars Program is going to do nothing but uplift them.
So many talented and brilliant people have walked the corridors of this amazing institution over the years. From Octavia Butler to Toni Morrison and James Baldwin, Ella Fitzgerald, Alvin Ailey, and Harry Belafonte, who graced the stage in this room of the American Negro Theater.
This place evokes great memories. It was a gift to us in our community to really try to find that space to reflect expressions of Black experience. I just knew that the environment, what I saw these young African Americans doing, was a place I needed to be.
What is my Schomburg Center? I'm standing here at the Cosmogram, which underneath holds the ashes of the poet Langston Hughes. On the evening when this Cosmogram was dedicated, people began to empty out of the auditorium. A jazz trio struck up. And to my amazement, Amira Baraka went over and asked Maya Angelou for a dance. And they started to dance on top of the Cosmogram, on top of the ashes of Langston Hughes. And I felt what a fitting way to kiss the memory of Langston.
The Schomburg Center is a research institute and a library, but it's so much more than that.
There's something going on every day.
So many amazing people come here to talk about their creative craft, to share what inspires them. The Schomburg Center's collections help to tell stories even beyond our walls.
The Schomburg Center is here in this exhibition at MoMA, One Way Ticket, Jacob Lawrence's migration series. We depend on the resources of the Schomburg to enable us to tell this story. Thinking about the implications of the past on the present is absolutely crucial for understanding the next steps, understanding what we have to do to go forward.
We today have the responsibility of making sure that new artists and activists, new scholars and poets know that this place continues to be a resource and a source of inspiration for the work that we must continue to do.
The Schomburg Center is knowledge.
The Schomburg Center, to me, is education.
The Schomburg Center is home. It is family. It is foundational.
The Schomburg Center is inspiration.
The Schomburg is with me in everything that I do.
Community, inside and out.
The Schomburg Center is us.
The Schomburg Center is you. And we invite each and every one of you to find your Schomburg Center.
Hello. Hello. Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Maira Liriano. I am the Associate Chief Librarian of the Jean Blackwell Hutson Research and Reference Division. It's one of the library research divisions of the Schomburg Center. My division is where you will find the published materials, books, magazines, newspapers, journals, lots of things that are online now, things that have been digitized, things available in databases, including many, many wonderful genealogy databases that you can access for free when you're here on site. And I'm very happy to be in conversation today with Beverly Scobie, who has written her family history into a book, which we'll be talking about today, and which she'll be presenting more of it to you. I am going to tell you a little bit more about Beverly, and I'm going to bring her out, and then she's going to read a little bit from the book, and she and I are going to sit down and talk about it, and then at the end we'll open it up for questions from all of you. So I actually met Beverly in person about a month and a half ago. I had received an invitation to go down to the consulate for Trinidad and Tobago. They were having a book launch for four different books that had recently been written, giving the history of Trinidad and Tobago. And so I went there with a couple of my colleagues, and I met Beverly, and it turns out that she and I had communicated a while ago, because she had done a lot of her research, or had done some of her research here for the book that we'll be talking about. And after I heard her speak, I invited her to come here and bring that information about her book to all of us here at the Schomburg Center. So Beverly Scobie was born in Sangre Grande, Trinidad, and grew up near the Cupano Roundabout, I hope I said that correctly, where the title of her book comes from. She is a graduate of the University of the West Indies and the Sir Woodling Law School. During I'm having some eye issues, and I actually normally wear contact lenses, and so I can't actually put my readers on top of my glasses. During her tenure as the assistant registrar at the Office of the Registrar General in Port of Spain, which is the capital of Trinidad and Tobago, she, while she was working there, she utilized her access to birth, marriage, and death records, which are the most important records to doing family history research, to learn more about her family. Beverly immigrated to the United States in 1984, but was still interested in her family history and continued to do the research from here. That led her to obtain a certificate in genealogical research from Boston University. And today, Beverly resides in Brooklyn, and where she wrote the book that we're presenting today, and continues to research and write about her family. Today, we will hear more about Beverly's book, Via the Roundabout, published in 2022, which traces her family's history in Tobago starting in 1819 and runs through the post-independence period in Trinidad and Tobago. Please help me in welcoming Beverly Scobie to come to the stage.
Hello, everyone. Good afternoon. Thank you so much for taking the time to come to listen to my presentation on Via the Roundabout. Thank you, Maira, for your introduction. So I will read two short passages from my book. In 2009, when I created a family tree, it helped me to better place relatives, some of whose stories were so fascinating that I decided to further research the more intriguing characters and the times in which they lived. This was when I took a second look at the family tree and did a serious assessment of who and what was needed. The display of information in this format was revealing as it highlighted missing relatives, some who showed up in unexpected places, others thought to be related, but were not. and still others left dangling from one single parent as I struggled to locate the next. Recurring gaps of nameless persons prompted me to seek out relatives, particularly older ones who might fill in some of the gaps while I captured their recollections before they were lost. Little did I know that this undertaking would involve so much more than adding stories to names. It took years of on and off research before I could even put together a reasonable semblance of my findings. Because my father's relatives were in rapid decline, I decided to start by documenting what I found of his maternal history. Few of my father's older relatives were alive, and it took years of persistence to find those who were willing to share information or be persuaded to share what they wished to share. I now had the task of connecting and arranging the fragments of what I was told into a coherent family story. This journey led to my reconnection in December 2009 with Victoria Leonce James, cousin Lee, whom I first met in 1971 while I attended high school. Cousin Lee's mother, Rebecca James Nee Arthur, and Mary Scobie Nee Arthur, my father's mother, were sisters. I mentioned my interest in meeting some of our older relatives to gather information about my father's mother and her side of the family. Cousin Lee shared information which whetted my appetite for more and caused me to question what I had been told of Mary, my father's mother. Cousin Lee mentioned, "You should talk to your cousins, the Arthur men." She said this with a mischievous smile. Between 2010 and 2014, I connected with a number of relatives, some of whom I met for the first time, some I had heard of and others I already knew. In 2011, I located Samuel Arthur, the son of Isaac Arthur, one of Mary and Rebecca's brothers. By the time I met him in person while on a visit to Trinidad in 2017, Samuel and I were familiar with each other, having exchanged family stories during our many telephone conversations. I described efforts I had made to document our family history, and he agreed to do DNA testing to assist in establishing the origins of our common lineage, a way of showing relatedness and correctly identifying our origins. While it sometimes happens that important details get lost in the telling and retelling of stories, I thought it better to preserve what I had found. Cordner children and their descendants passed on stories of Margaret, the family matriarch. Margaret's story retains sufficient information for me to identify, connect, and place persons and events mentioned within their historical context. This helped me to authenticate accounts which might otherwise seem outlandish, with documentary evidence that confirms the existence of these ancestors and their times. I chanced upon Joseph Arthur, another ancestor whom I had not heard of. The relatives to whom I spoke were oblivious to his existence because no one had mentioned him. This was an unexpected find for me as I established his place among my ancestors. Descendants who left Tobago to work on the cocoa estates of Sans Souci, Togo, in Trinidad, brought the ethos of ancestors, asserting themselves as proud, vibrant people who helped to shape what for them was a new environment. They did what they knew best, toiling away to carve out portions of land where they and their families could thrive. demographic evidence of their existence is captured in the island's births, deaths, marriages, and land deed registers, which may appear sterile to future generations as they do to me now. Here, I am supplementing those demographics by telling some of their stories. Why is it important for me to relate my family's history? Margaret and Joseph Arthur were sons and daughters who, once enslaved, were looked upon as chattel, a piece of property to be bought, sold, given, inherited. They had no voice. Mostly viewed as an amorphous collective, their humanity, essence, and individuality were smothered by the brutal practices of chattel slavery, the traumatic effects of which is evident in descendant generations. They reflect the larger diaspora of souls whose names may not be known and whose stories may never be told, but who similarly endured the Middle Passage and enslavement. Records of my original ancestors when they exist are in slave registers. Records used to assess compensation due to owners deprived of their means of livelihood. Now, the only source of documented information concerning ancestors, some of whose names I had barely heard, stark, brittle, crumbling pages in cold archives, which quantify their existence but nullify their humanity. My ancestors were enslaved people who, for the most part, are reduced to one-line generic abbreviations. By writing their stories, I hope to restore the essence of their spirit and humanity, to amplify their presence with a sense of gravity, if only for the time spent reading about them, allowing future generations a backward glance to connect with legendary ancestors. My next piece will be my grandmother, Mary. I was able to piece together information surrounding Mary's circumstances from the generous memories of relatives like my cousin Paul Philip, whom I got the chance to speak with. Mary Arthur, the last daughter of Joseph and Harriet Arthur, shared a close resemblance to older sisters Annie and Diana. She was described as a tall, slender young lady of light brown complexion with long, silky black plaits which reached down to her waist. She would have had a comfortable life at home with her parents as the last of four daughters, with four older brothers and one younger. She was no older than 17 years in 1902 when her parents gave their consent and she married James Robinson Scobie of Lambo, Tobago, an older man who may have shaved years off his age. Discrepancies later showed up on his son's birth certificate. She was the opposite of her husband in physical appearance. James was a person of small stature and dark skin, a complexion similar to his son's. Mary got married before her older sister Rebecca did, and it isn't clear if older sisters Annie and Diana were already married at the time. It was unusual for a younger daughter to precede an older sister in marriage in a society shaped by Victorian norms, especially in matters relating to the conduct of proper young women. Parents were formally asked for their daughter's hand in marriage, usually by letter. The suitor received a formal response from the parents, who tried to ensure that marriage was to a man of means who could provide for their daughter. Parents did not allow a younger daughter to marry before older sisters, except in unusual circumstances. James Scobie may well have been brought up comfortably as an only child. His father was named as the beneficiary to a sizable sum of money. James owned property and a few head of cattle. He was a skilled carpenter and had a good job with the local government. James and his wife Mary had five children: Edward, Imelda, Amelia, Joseph, and Alpheus, my father, all of whom were born in Lambo, Tobago. The family returned to Cumana from Lambo shortly after Mary had her baby, Alpheus. One morning, soon after their return, Mary got up, left her sleeping baby, and calmly walked down to the beach, where she slipped into the warm, indifferent water of the Caribbean Sea and began swimming towards Tobago, a distance of some 22 miles away. Thank you.
Thank you, Beverly. That was really powerful. I have some questions for you so we can kind of dive in a little deeper into the book and learn more about your ancestors. But to start with, tell us about the journey that led you to writing this book, and how did you get started doing genealogical research, and when did you know that your research would lead to writing a book?
Sure. I was always curious from a very early age, and my curiosity was piqued by the constant flow of visitors who came to the family home. They dropped by to see my parents and the children. My mother would explain who were blood relatives and who were just friends, while my father mostly listened, if within earshot. Maybe because he was more the disciplinarian. As I became familiar with my proximity to relatives, I began to build a tree in my head. This was when I realized that my mother and my father shared the same surname. Her name was Scobie before she was married to him. The name was uncommon back then, and like my mother always said, all Scobies are related. This puzzled me because I knew that somehow cousins were not supposed to get married to each other. So, were they related? When I asked my mother, she said they were, but she was unable to explain how, and of course I dare not ask my father. Meanwhile, my father had a very amusing way of assigning relatives whom he didn't care for to my mother. He would say, your mother's family. The thought of my parents' relatedness remained in my head. Maybe I could find out how that came to be. It was when my mother mentioned that she knew her great-grandmother, Rosie, who had been enslaved. This revelation got my full attention. At the time, I was learning about the Atlantic slave trade at school and quickly realized that my mother knew a slave. I questioned her closely as she recalled taking lunch to Rosie. The lunch consisted of fish head and callaloo, which was part of the fare for enslaved people. Of course, I asked her, well, what did Rosie have to say about slavery?
Her only offering in that regard was that she had heard it said that Rosie was stolen as a child from her parents in Africa. I now had two tasks at hand, finding out how my parents were related and finding Rosie. Now, I got started with my amateur genealogical research by taking notes. When my mother told stories, I would take notes. It wasn't always consistent, but I did do jottings. This became somewhat formalized when, after I graduated from law school, I worked at the Registrar General's office, where all the records, births, deaths, marriages, land registers, and other records were kept. So now I had a full array of records before me, and I could look for some of the names that my mother had mentioned to me. So, of course, in my downtime, I started looking for names. Hold up, not so easy. My mother had told me about people. She called them by their nickname or home name, whereas the records were formalized records with Christian names. So I didn't know who was who. Except it was really obvious. I had to dig, and I didn't get much information, even when my mother tried to help. So, when you do your research, just remember people have home names, but you need to connect those home names to the formalized Christian names. I learned to do that later on. It's a bit of a process. Mm-hmm. When did I decide that I should write a book? When I created a family tree, a number of trees, in 2009, my mother's stories were already blended with the teachings I had learned at school about the Atlantic slave trade. I continued to document information as I listened to her, and I would build descriptions of ancestors. One of my goals was to place the names of all my original ancestors at the top of the family tree where they belong. So that means I now had the task of finding them, every single one. This research took a number of years and entailed traveling back and forth to Trinidad, Tobago, and Barbados, where I gathered information from the National Archives, libraries, church records, cemeteries, interviewing church personnel and older persons with recall, which included my mother, as always. I traveled further afield to the National Archives, Kew Gardens, London, the British Library, and the University of London School of Oriental and African Studies, and of course, to the Schomburg Center. This renowned institution devoted to the research and preservation of and exhibition of materials focused on African American, the African diaspora, and African experiences. In addition to hearing from people who knew of my work, when I evaluated the breadth of research I had done, the thought entered my mind that it would be a great idea to create a family history book, a compilation of my research. I had improved my genealogy research and knowledge skills, created family trees, traced original ancestors, done DNA mapping. I had captured the experiences of ancestors who were stolen from their homeland, Africa, survived the Middle Passage and Atlantic slavery, only to be enslaved on plantations all over the world. This is the story of all of us. I needed to write it, and I did.
That's quite a journey.
It was.
And it's so much of genealogy, when people get started, it's about dates and, you know, names and dates and locations, and and just creating that family tree, but then there's the stories, you know, that the oral history, and together with the facts and you know those evidences that people collect, it just makes it so much more interesting to have the stories as well, because you know at a certain point when people do their genealogy, they get excited because they're building their tree, but then it's also important to understand the times that they lived in, what was happening around them, and then obviously more importantly, like what is some of the stories that will get passed down, and then viewing your ancestors in a different light because you understand better now maybe what they were going through. But I'm really curious, and I know when people write family histories and they discover that maybe some ancestors they didn't know anything about or didn't even know existed, you know, if you had a particular favorite ancestor that you discovered while doing your research.
Absolutely. Joseph Arthur, my father's grandfather. It's that close. So while putting together the leaves on the family tree, finding people, I heard of Daddy's mother, Mary, but I never really heard of her father. So, while looking at slave registers, which had been released in 2009, I decided to focus in on the Caribbean, in Trinidad. These records had been created after slavery was abolished in 1807. In order to keep track of enslaved people, to somewhat ensure that no new persons were enslaved or added to the rolls, so that those rolls would increase by birth of new children, or they would decrease by attrition, the death of slaves. So that was the original reason why these records were created by the British government in the British colonies, so that these records were finally released in 2009. Wow. While looking through the records, I, just like that, on a whim, I decided to put the name Joseph Arthur. Normally, the slave records do not give names, they will give a color, moko, mulatto, something like that. They'll give a possible age, height, and where you're from. I put the name Joseph Arthur, and two names popped up. A 23-year-old personal slave in Mauritius. He belonged to a Daniel McKay. He was from Mozambique. And a baby in Barbados with the same name. That was really puzzling because, first of all, enslaved people didn't really have their own names. They were given a part of the name of their master, or maybe if he was tall, they call him Tall Boy, or you know, some name, random name that was made up. But to actually find two human beings with the name, the baby in Barbados with the same name as the young man in Mozambique, that was startling. So I noted it because it was Joseph Arthur, and these are all of the records, so that there is no other Joseph Arthur somewhere. I knew that my grandmother's brother, his name was Joseph Arthur. So there we go. Believe it or not, there's something called presentism when I'm writing, and I'm sure when people are writing, if you are writing about the past, you try to create the atmosphere that existed back then so that things won't necessarily be like they are now. So I did a lot of other reading to get information to create that atmosphere. One day while reading this book, Melancholy Isle by Douglas Archibald, my eyes rolled back. What did I just read? Joseph Arthur, formerly enslaved in Barbados, moved to Tobago, where he was one of three who started an insurrection to burn down the town of Scarborough, rape the woman, and pillage the place.
Wow.
Amazing. So, I guess it's the same person. That's the baby who, as a young person, came to Tobago to live. He spent 4 years in prison, after which he received a pardon, and he is described as having gone on to live this wonderful life with his family. I do believe that he is the person who married Harriet Corden, a much younger woman. You see, they had 9 children, a much younger woman. So he would have died, he would have passed on before he could gel, before he could leave Tobago to even come to Trinidad when most of the family migrated. So he got lost in Tobago, but that's my favorite ancestor.
Wow, that's amazing. Not only did you live an amazing life, but the way you discovered him is... It's almost like it was destined for you to find him, and that those records were only released in 2009.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
That took a long time. Wow. What do you hope this book can impart to your readers?
First of all, that slavery is not a myth. It did happen. I found them, my ancestors. When you read my book, you will find that I had DNA mapping done to pinpoint my family origins. Many of us, our ancestors were enslaved. Oh, I'm sorry. Oh my God, should I start again? I'm sorry. I would like readers to know that slavery is not a myth. It did happen. I found them, my ancestors. When you read my book, you will find that I had DNA mapping done to pinpoint my family origins. Many of us, our ancestors were enslaved. I thought to humanize ancestors who were thought of as chattel. I also think there is need for reparations for the loss of life and hope inflicted on our ancestors. The vestiges of which we struggle to live with every day. For example, generational mental illness. Could it have originated from the trauma inflicted during and after slavery? My hope is that each of you gain some insight on how to begin or continue your family tree research. It is not as intimidating as you may think and can be lots of fun. Yes, there is always the dark side to life. Be prepared. Do you know who you are? To be ignorant of what occurred before you were born is to remain always a child. For what is the worth of human life unless it is woven into the life of our ancestors by the records of history? Marcus Cicero.
What advice would you give someone who is starting out doing their family history?
Always talk to older relatives or even close family friends who know your family. Visit the places where your parents or other ancestors originated. Try to get familiar with county records. Do research at the Schomburg Center, of course. and take copious notes as often as possible. Now, note-taking is an art. Sometimes one has to be subtle, as in making quick jottings at the end of a conversation. Why? The mere presence of pen and paper could be intimidating and arouse suspicion for some relatives. Why you want to write that? Why you want to embarrass us by telling the family secrets? You're looking to make money off me, right? So talk to them.
I want to leave some time for Q&A, so I'm going to just ask one last question, which is, how did this, writing this book and learning more about your family, how did it change you?
I would say it deepened my introspection and sense of who I am through knowing who my people were. I became more understanding, I believe, and empathetic to family dynamics which shape our lives, my own and that of others, descendants and enslavers. We unconsciously learn so much by mimicking what we see in our families. A lot of it originated in the negativity of slavery. This has been practiced for generations. Some of the behaviors, some of them are diluted, and we always have to make a conscious effort to do better. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Beverly. I don't know if anyone in the audience has questions. If there's a mic in the back, if you don't mind going back, that way everyone can hear your question. Thank you so much. If anyone else has questions, you're welcome to go in the back and line up if you have.
Hello, Beverly, it's Allison. How are you?
Hi.
Hi, Allison.
Thank you so much for your wonderful book. It's a tremendous story. I just wanted to kind of talk about the Caribbean end of doing the research, because a lot of our research from the Caribbean are in the Caribbean. So coming to America to do the research, you pretty much are kind of at a loggerheads where you can't really get to all the information. So what was your process? Did you have to spend more time in Trinidad and Tobago getting the records, or did you have access to them from stateside?
Okay, I had to travel to Trinidad and Tobago and Barbados to get the records. The slave registers are accessible on ancestry.com, which is a very expensive proposition. I got access when I was doing some studying at Boston University. But basically, Trinidad and Tobago in particular, you would have to go to the country. There are other islands that where some of their records are digitized and you could access them online, but the process isn't quite complete in Trinidad and Tobago. So you would need to take a trip, but it's worth it.
And I was saying hi to Allison, because that's Allison Kwame, who worked at the Schomburg Center for many years, is a former colleague of mine. So nice to see you, Allison. And I will put a plug for the Schomburg Center and also the New York Public Library, because throughout the New York Public Library system, you can access ancestry.com. And the version that we have at the library is called Ancestry Library Edition. It's pretty much the same product that you can subscribe to as an individual. The big difference is that you can't save your records because it's a shared account, and that's why it's called Ancestry Library Edition. You do have to come into the library to use it. It's only available on site, but it is available at any of the New York Public Library locations, including the Schomburg Center. You can also bring your own laptop and access our Wi-Fi. As long as you're connected to the New York Public Library's Wi-Fi, you can access Ancestry. We also have access to many other subscription-type genealogy databases. There's one, for instance, called Find My Past, which is the British sort of version of Ancestry. And I know as time passes, you know, more and more records are being digitized all the time, and it's a very changing landscape. So it's always worth coming back, checking in, talking to librarians to find out what might be available online, because it does change. And there may be records available now that hadn't been available in the past. Do we have any other questions? I see there's someone over here.
Hi, thank you for writing your book. My question, I'll just tell a small story first. My oldest child lived in Mexico for about a year. And from that, they celebrated the Day of the Dead, Dios de Muertos. And so recently we did it at our house, and my daughter's partner kind of watched videos of her ancestors, or just, you know, like old videos. And it kind of was a ritual to talk about your ancestors and celebrate them. And I noticed people around the world do that. You know, Asian people do it, African people do it. We don't do it so much here in America. So I guess my question is, do you have, or have you established rituals with your family, or like days where you pass on information about elders to the younger people in your family? Or is it just something that kind of happens around the dinner table or at Thanksgiving? Or is there, you know, kind of one day or a birthday or things of that sort where you kind of pass on orally information about their ancestors, your ancestors as well?
Okay, well, first I have to establish that I am a family of one, me. Right. My siblings live in other parts of the world, and we connect from time to time. But as I grew up, there were eight of us at my home, and my mother was the chief storyteller. She would always tell stories about various relatives. Up to her last breath, she passed in 2017, she was still coherent. And I would call her almost every day, and I would, you know, ask her to tell me stories, tell me things about what happened. The family rituals, as you mentioned, the Day of the Dead in Trinidad and Tobago, it is celebrated. My older sister told me that what happened is my grandmother took her to the cemetery where the Rosie, the original enslaved lady, where she had been buried. They would go there at the end of October. They would clean the cemetery. There was a peace lily there, and they would light candles. The Moravian church in Maria, Tobago, which they belong to, they still have a candlelight procession, which we call All Saints, one night, November 1st, and All Souls, November 2nd. So it's celebrated in a bigger way. But I know in my family, you know, I heard most of the stories that I put together here. But people still celebrate some of those occasions.
And of course, your family has a book, so that's always good. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yes.
Not here. No, I don't think
so. Yeah, it seems a little...
Okay, it's on now.
Yes, it's...
Okay, hi, everyone. My name is Megan Sylvester, and I am from Trinidad and Tobago, just like Beverly Scobie. And I wanted to ask her a question in particular, because my family is also from Sandy Grande in Trinidad. And the interesting thing is that in trying to get the backstory of your ancestors, what I have encountered is a reluctance from older folk to share their stories, because they feel as though you're digging up history that ought to be left uncovered. So I am wondering, Beverly, how did you go about that process? Is it that you would say that your mother, who you said was a chief storyteller, is it that she was willing and the rest of your family was willing to share? Or did you receive some resistance in the early days of trying to uncover the family's history?
Yeah, lots of resistance to the point where there are people who don't even speak to me. But so my mother loved to talk, but she wouldn't like just spill all the beans. She probably would come back tomorrow with some of the story. But she's different. And I guess as I grew older, she felt more comfortable sharing with me. And I had developed the skills of knowing what questions to ask. But generally, if I may say it, that, you know, African people don't really like to talk much about what went on, which includes slavery. That's why I was shocked when she told me she knew a slave. You know, and I'm using the word in that context, an enslaved person. But yeah, there's lots of resistance, and it takes a lot of prying and time and get to the gossipy relative. And yeah, you get a lot of information there.
Thanks so very much. I appreciate the answer.
You're welcome.
There's another question back here.
Hi, June.
A 20-year friendship. And I want to say, first of all, I think very important, if you have a chance, look at the book. It's one of the most beautifully crafted books I've ever seen in terms of biography. Usually there are a few pages in the middle that maybe give you some history and you feel bad for cheating on it. But all these pictures you've been seeing are now run along with the text. So it's really one of the most extraordinary biographies I've ever experienced. And that's just not because I'm a friend. It's because I believe it.
Okay, so. Thank you.
Let me just say that I thought there were two things that I wanted to probe you a little bit about, maybe that you haven't quite asked about. You sort of mentioned them now again, so I want to bring them up. One is, did you mention how old your mother was when she passed away, when she still had her marbles?
She was almost 200. She was almost 103 years old.
And I wondered if you had other relatives who were similarly old. I mean, that's a wonderful thing to have happened, right, as a storyteller.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, she was coherent right up until almost end, and she would always be willing to share stories.
And the other one, the woman who asked you a question before, I want to say I think she touched on something, but I wanted to just probe it a little bit more. What I know about Caribbean countries and the way it works, that churches and parishes can be a major source of record keeping and real documentation, that births were recognized, were entered in books there that might not have even been other places, marriages. And I don't know, did that play a big part in it?
Yeah,
were you able to take advantage of that?
Actually, where I worked, what happens, or what happened then with record collection, is that each little county, each little town, you would have somebody who is a registrar. So if you had a baby, you would go to them and give them the information. They would collect all that information, births, deaths, marriages. Well, the churches would collect the marriages mostly and the deaths. And those records would be brought to a central place, the Red House, and housed at the Registrar General, and they would be transcribed into records. But, hold a minute. So, while I was working and finding one or two records, later on, one of those records proved to be the only link I had to connect my father's ancestry, because I actually went to the church where the records were kept. There was a hurricane which destroyed a lot of the records. The parish priest at the time took some of the records back to England to repair, and he and the records disappeared. Apart from which, I think there was some machinations about me not finding those particular records, which you'll read in. But yes, they do exist in other places. But they kept in the central repository.
I just one small question, which may show my ignorance. You dated the end of slavery in Trinidad and Tobago was 1807, and I've always heard that the end of the manumission was 1834 in the British colonies.
So. Okay, I'm sorry, maybe I didn't put it over correctly. Slavery was abolished in 18. Slavery was abolished in 1807, abolished, and the records were kept so that people wouldn't be encouraged to do underhand trafficking, so that the numbers, if there was, you know, anything would show in the numbers. Of course, slavery continued, but then it was abolished in 1833, continued during a period of emancipation up until 1838, which period was said to get the formerly enslaved accustomed to being free. Oh my God. Okay, thank you. I appreciate it.
You're welcome.
Thank you. Well, I'm going to take the last question because we've been seeing these wonderful photographs of your ancestors and your relatives, and I'm wondering, what was the process of collecting these? Were these photos that your mom and your dad had, or did you get some of these from your other relatives? Or did you find any of these in archives and other repositories?
Actually,
I
got some from other relatives, but my family always kept lots of photo albums, which various children would claim. And I was lucky to get some of the remaining ones during my trip home when my mother passed. But we always had photos, which we kept. And I have to say thanks to Paria Publishers, who produced my book. They are in Trinidad and Tobago. They gave me a lot of the black and white photos, which were a part of their archives. So they contributed those to my book. All the colored photos are photos I took on my own, and others are family photos.
Wonderful. Well, I know we have a few copies of your book available in the shop, in the Schomburg shop. And unfortunately, we didn't have as many copies as we wanted. Yes, I'm going to get to that one. We didn't have as many copies to sell, but we also have a handout that if it sells out, we have a handout where you can order copies. Yep. And it's being waved at over here. Okay. So what's up next for you, Beverly?
Well, Via the Roundabout is the first of what I hope is a trilogy of my family's history, spanning the last quarter of the 1700s to the mid-1900s. As you would have learned, my family tree is three-pronged. Since my mother and father came from the same ancestor, most people are four. So that's why it's a trilogy. I was able to follow the crumbs and pinpoint the intricacies as to how my parents are related. A fascinating story, which reaches its conclusion in the next volume.
This is a cliffhanger.
Unfortunately, my father passed away before I could explain the details to him, but I was able to do so for my mother, whom, when I asked her, "Mother, what did your mother who married a Scobie say to you when you voiced your intentions to marry another Scobie?" Her reply was, "If he's a good man, you should marry him."
Okay, and we'll end on that note. Well, thank you very much for coming. Beverly's going to be out in the lobby if you have additional questions that you want to ask, also to pick up the book. And in a few minutes, we're holding a genealogy workshop down in the Research and Reference Division, my division downstairs.
So you're welcome to join that as well. That will be an introduction to doing your family history research. Otherwise, please come back to the Schomburg Center. Come back to visit me and my staff, and other librarians down in the Research and Reference Division, where we can assist you in accessing whatever information we have that can help you do your genealogy research, including all those fabulous databases, including historical newspapers, other family histories. This is our copy of Roundabout that's in the collection. We have a lot, very rich collection of family histories, as well as local histories, which is also very important when you're doing this kind of research. So thank you so much for coming. Enjoy the rest of your time here at the Schomburg Center at our open house, and come back again. Thank you.